Welcome to this intro to Raman Spectroscopy. My name is Max and I work at Penn State University. Raman spectroscopy is a vibrational spectroscopy technique in which we are measuring scattered light off of your molecule or crystal. There are two forms of scattered light. There's elastic scattered light, in which there's no net change in the photon in and the photon out. And there's inelastic scattering, in which there is a net change between the photon in and the scattered photon out. Raman is a form of this inelastic scattering. And there are two types of Raman scattering. There are anti-Stokes and Stokes shift. An anti-Stokes change or shift is a transition from a high vibrational energy level to a low vibrational energy level. And a Stokes shift is a transition from a low energy to a high energy level. Shown here is a generic Raman cartoon spectra, where we see that the x-axis is in units of Raman shift, which is really a shorthand for relative wave number change. And it's relative to whatever wavelength laser that we're using. So that value at zero is the elastic scattered line. And it will always be zero regardless of what wavelength laser we're using because it's relative to that source. The shifts that we see, these inelastic scattering shifts or the Raman shifts, correspond to the energy delta that we see in the Jablonski energy diagram up above. And what you'll notice is that energy delta is the same for both anti-Stokes and Stokes. They're just opposite in sign. So the Raman spectra is always symmetric between the anti-Stokes and Stokes features. Now we see there are a number of modes that are drawn out there. And what dictates the modes that are present in your material depends upon whether or not there is a change in the polarizability tensor as a function of the vibration. Shown here is the CO2 symmetric stretch. And what we see is there is a net change in the polarizability tensor with respect to the normal mode of the vibration. So this value is not zero, and therefore it is Raman active. However, for anti-symmetric stretch of CO2, there is no net change in the polarizability tensor. This value equals zero, and then therefore is not Raman active. There are a number of features that we monitor in the Raman spectra to identify what's going on in your sample. Firstly, we'll study the characteristic frequencies that are present in the spectra to interpret the composition of the material generally. There's a caveat to this, however, and that is that we cannot identify the elements present via this technique. So it is a good idea to couple this with some other elemental analysis if you do not know what elements are present. Changes in the peak position correspond to a change in the strain state of your material. Raman scattering is highly polarization dependent, and by manipulating this, we can actually identify the symmetry of the Raman modes that are detected. And if you're looking at a single crystal sample, you can actually identify the orientation of that specimen. The full width half max of a solid material corresponds to the crystallinity of that material. The narrower the band, the higher the crystallinity. If it's broader, more amorphous. Lastly, the intensity of the peak is dependent upon a number of factors, some of those being the polarizability tensor change, as well as the concentration of the material. So what I have shown here are four spectra of all of cyclooctosulfur, or S8 molecule, for alpha S8, beta S8, gamma S8, and biosulfur, also known as liquid sulfur. So here is that molecule S8 that's present in all of these samples. And what I'm showing here in this highlighted region now are what we refer to as the internal modes of the Raman spectra. So these are the vibrations that are unique to the internal structure of this molecule. And what you see is that the features between these four specimens are more or less the same because it is the same molecule. But when we look at the low frequency region of the Raman spectra, This is referred to as the external modes, or in the case of a crystalline material, these are the lattice modes of your material. And shown on the left are the different crystal structures of alpha, beta, and gamma, S8. And what we see is they're uniquely different, and correspondingly, the low frequency response in the Raman is uniquely different. So using the Raman spectra, in particular the low frequency, one can actually scan a sample to identify what allotrope is present. And what I have shown here is a Raman map that's been rendered and overlaid on top of an optical micrograph. What we do is we scan point by point. Each of these pixels actually contains a full spectra, and we compare that spectra to these references to identify what specimen is present within that defined region. So within this specimen here, which is a thiothrix bacteria that actually encapsulates elemental sulfur from the environment into these little globules, we can identify what allotrope of sulfur is present. In the living thiothrix example, which is actually in an aqueous solution, which is generally not very much of an issue in Raman spectra, we can actually scan materials in an aqueous solution, we identify that the sulfur present is in a biosulfur or liquid sulfur. However, once we dry that specimen out, we identified that the crystal structure is changed and there's actually quite significant heterogeneity present within the sample, showing that within a small region defined and scanned, we see both gamma S8 and beta S8, shown in blue. This is probably one of the only or few ways that you could actually scan and identify these allotropes within these two specimens. So when else would you use Raman? There are a number of fields and examples that are shown on this Hariba webpage, and I welcome you to go visit to investigate some of these categories further. I've also listed out some of the advantages and disadvantages of this technique. Advantages being that this technique allows us to identify the bonding information on a submicron scale, as shown in that previous example in the sulfur bacteria. We can probe a wide range of materials in a number of states, including solids, liquids, gases. Generally, we're doing this under an ambient condition. However, we can also scan this under a vacuum. As I mentioned previously, we can do this in an aqueous environment, also studying dynamic processes. We can depth profile because these systems are actually coupled to a confocal microscope. So as long as the material is transparent or semi-transparent within the visible spectrum, we can probe through the material. And as long as you can couple light in and out of any design that you've created, you have quite a freedom to the experimental design for your setup. And some of the in-situ capabilities are listed here. Some of the disadvantages being that fluorescing materials often will drown out the Raman signal. This can be avoided by the selection of the excitation laser sometimes. The laser itself can sometimes be an issue, and it can degrade the material, so you have to be careful about that and the power that you use when doing your scans. As mentioned previously, there's no elemental information provided from this technique. And Raman scattering is also a low probability light interaction. And, you know, historically it was one of the hang-ups for this technique, but throughout the years, this has definitely improved. Our ability to detect the light has improved. And limit of detection of most materials is around 1%. However, that can change depending on circumstances. And there are a limited number of free databases out there for spectral interpretation, which can make that a bit challenging. Here at Penn State, we have a number of Raman systems and laser choices to select from. We also have a wide range of functionality that's capable of most of these tools. So we have DuoScan, which allows us to reduce the beam damage. As I mentioned previously, we can scan low frequency. We can actually do co-localized AFM Raman, as well as tip-enhanced Raman. We can overlay any number of optical microscopy techniques with the Raman image or Raman spectra. And we have in-house temperature and environmental chamber in-situ capabilities as well. So I thank you for your time and your interest, and have a great day.